Hello and welcome to the Mutual Fund Show. My name is Neeraj Shah. Over the next 25-30 minutes, we'll talk all about mutual funds. The topic for today is something that a lot of people have requested us to probe into greater detail. Direct investing versus regular funds investing. Simply put, two different NAVs and what's good for an investor. And we have got three experts today to try and explore each aspect of this. Somebody who's in favor of direct investing, and which is Kunal Bajaj of MobiKwik. Tarun Birani, he strides both the spheres of thinkman.in, and he's got a view both in favor and against direct investing. And then Amol Joshi of PlanRupee, who essentially favors the regular plan of sorts and tries and gives his view on why is it that investors should, or there is still value in having an advisor even though it comes at a cost. Now, let me first start off this conversation with showing you four charts of four funds. And frankly, if you just look at the returns between direct and regular funds, and if you just look at the cost arbitrage out there, they probably are a no-brainer. Let's bring those charts up out here on the screen. And Axis Blue Chip or a DSP Small Cap or a Mirae fund. This is the Axis Blue Chip fund. And I think we've taken the five-year performance of these funds. And as you can see, over the course of 5 years, the returns that this fund would have given between the two plans, the direct plan versus the regular plan, there is a stark difference in the quantum of returns that have come in. These are the return charts, mind you, and not necessarily the NAV chart. These are the return charts. But as you can see towards the fag end of the screen, that the quantum of returns between the two categories differ. Marginally, but differ. And over a long period of time, they would probably differ a lot more. I can get some other examples of funds existing within the current landscape and the kind of returns that have given. The Mirae Asset India Equity Fund, again, direct versus regular. And if you can see, while they started off together on the returns front, because that's when you invest in, but over a period of 4 or 5 years, and since mutual funds are instruments for a longer period of time, you would see that the returns differ, and differ quite materially in almost every specific fund. And with the power of compounding over a period of 15, 20, 25, 30 years, if you're indeed a long-term investor, these returns can be meaningful. So why should you choose regular plans over direct plans, if there is an argument for that? And what kind of investor should go for regular plans versus what kind of investor should go for direct plans? I think that's the conversation that we're aiming to have today. Let's start off for this conversation with Kunal Bajaj of MobiKwik. Kunal, good having you. Thanks so much for joining in. Over the last few shows that we've done, and I know you are in favor of direct investing. The argument for somebody to invest via the direct route in a market like India, which is not necessarily so well understood.
So I think the first thing to understand is really the difference between regular and direct. And, you know, that's something that most people intuitively don't get. A regular fund and a direct fund are the exact same fund, run by the exact same fund manager, investing in the exact same stocks or bonds, with one crucial difference. The difference is that in a regular plan, there is a regular commission being paid to somebody. In a direct plan, no commission is paid to anyone. That regular commission doesn't come out of thin air. You know, magically somebody starts earning money by recommending a particular fund or scheme to you. That regular commission comes out of the investor's savings, out of his life savings, out of what he wants to save for his family, for his kids, for his retirement. That essentially is the difference between the two. So the concept is very, very clear. If you do think you can do this yourself, if you can, you know, find a platform that lets you allows you to invest in a direct fund at a very, very convenient manner, in a simple manner, there's absolutely no reason why somebody should choose a regular fund and have a regular lifetime of his savings being actually drained away. Something that he or she is really working for.
Interesting. You, in your experience, Kunal, of people investing through your platform or otherwise, have you seen over a period of time some substantial variation in the returns that would have come in? I mean, I've used your site calculators, for example, and I think in a bunch of funds or a bunch of enumerations that you put out, you show that the differential that happens between different time frames can be quite exaggerated.
Sure. So, you know, the argument that most people will tell you, right, is that the small commissions don't matter. I mean, how much is 1% anyway, right? You just think about 1% and it doesn't really matter. But it does matter, and it matters in a very significant way. And let's look at it in two different methods, right? In one way, you look at it and you say it's 1% a year. It's not 1% at the time of investing. So it isn't that you bought a house and you paid 1% away to a broker. You're actually paying that rent of 1% every single year to keep living in that particular house or apartment. And when you add up over a 30-year life cycle that we have, you know, by the time we start work in our mid-20s and we retire in our mid-60s, that 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 will add up to about 30% of your savings. That is what you will stand up losing when you buy a regular fund, you know, and you know you can earn that much more by buying a direct fund and obviously retire that much more comfortably. Okay. Another way of looking at it is, again, look at that 1% as a percentage of returns. So let's take the argument that 1% doesn't matter. Obviously, 1 upon 100 doesn't matter. It's a small enough number. But another way to look at it is, how much do you expect to earn each year? If you expect to earn each year about 8%, giving away 1% of that is giving away 1 upon 8. That's 12.5% you're giving away of your returns every single year. And that's significant. So, you know, you have to look at it as a holistic, you know, your entire costs of actually making, doing a transaction, of staying invested. And obviously still try and make the best decision, you know, with the guidance that you have and with the platforms that you have available today.
Amol, come in on this, because the clients that you cater to are obviously giving you that whatever percent the number may be.
Sure.
Now, if we just look at the bare returns, the argument is a no-brainer. You got to go for direct because the returns over a period of time would be high. But there is obviously the model that is working on the other side for so many years, which is people are choosing an advisor to help them with their investments. What's the argument right now when a bunch of funds are barely beating the index and therefore it's not really a hard choice to make when you're choosing large cap funds? Is it? Is there an argument for paying a commission to an advisor?
Right. So Neeraj, at the very beginning, you mentioned that when you look at purely the numbers, it's a no-brainer. So I completely agree with you. I completely agree with Kunal. All things remaining equal, direct versus regular is a no contest. Direct will win every day of the week simply because it's cheaper. But now we have to get out of the studio and go. We actually have to hit the ground. Now, I have met clients of various, you know, various temperaments and various thought processes. As we are discussing here, direct plans are cheaper, right? And hence the NAV grows faster. People have found out, or there are investors who think that since it is costing me more, I will get less number of units, and people choose to prefer to go with regular funds. I'm not stating that as an argument for regular fund. I'll come to that. But I'm saying that direct versus regular should not be looked at in isolation. That's simply because investors have to understand what they're getting into. That's number one. Number two, very important, how many people can afford a direct plan? Now, this is very funny. Direct plans is cheaper, so everybody should be able to afford that, right? We in India know that in Indian mutual fund space, we know that average ticket size of an SIP is about 3,000 rupees. Let's say that every person has 5 SIPs. So the monthly outgo of a standard Indian mutual fund investor is 15,000 rupees. Per annum, the investment is 1.8 lakhs. Now, a distributor, any distributor, or any even a bank that acts as distributor, if the commission outgo is 1%, the customer is getting service at 1,800 rupees per annum, any and every kind of service and incidental advice that one can think of. Now, I really want to know, are there any platforms or are there enough fee-only advisors who would cater to an investor day in, day out for the year for 1,000 or 2,000 rupees kind of fees? And thereby my argument, can a small investor really afford direct plan? So there is a case that there are outfits, the small distributors and even the larger distribution outfits, popularly known as national distributors, who have an army of individual distributors, they are able to cater to these clients. So direct plans are better, but I wouldn't say that they are better for everyone, simply because people cannot afford, or every investor in Indian mutual fund landscape can't afford direct plan.
Interesting. You know, just before I get to Tarun, Kunal, you are itching to give an answer to that. And this is not a contest here, by the way. Viewers, please keep in mind, all three of them are friends. All three of them cater to a lot of clients. But just trying to make an argument or two around each of these plans. Kunal, you want to come in?
Sure. So, you know, we've launched mutual fund investing just this Monday. That's 2 days ago on MobiKwik. And we've had about 200,000 investors actually sign up for this in the last 2 days. And the idea really is, you know, just make it extremely simple, extremely frictionless, and really easy for customers to be able to reach their goals. People's goals are really simple, right? You can either bucket them into a goal for retirement or for kids' education or for, you know, travel overseas or a house or a vehicle. or you can bucket into a goal and say, I know I need 25 lakhs in 10 years' time or in 5 years' time, right? Whatever that goal might be. The idea is that at the end of the day, we're not creating product for that customer. We're offering a simple vanilla solution. That solution really is put a certain amount in large cap equities, put a certain amount in debt, diversify by putting a certain amount into bonds as well, into fixed income funds as well. And if we can do that as a really easy solution, you know, deliver that to people on an app that they're using day in and day out for their payments, for their investments, for their insurance transactions, make it really frictionless, I think that solution can actually go to the masses and, you know, doesn't need a human being for intervention for these kind of solutions. To put it in a different way, we can celebrate the successes of the mutual fund industry. I think we've done a fabulous job in terms of assets under management, as you've probably seen on many shows, people talking about the AUM growth. Mm. But we've actually spectacularly failed in financial inclusion. It is 25 or 26 years since the first mutual fund was announced. I'm not talking about UTI, Morgan Stanley Growth Fund, where people were standing in fort on PM Road through the middle of the night to apply for that mutual fund at 10 rupees per unit. Right? That is 25 or 26 years ago. After 26 years, you have 1.8 crore investors. That is the estimated number of investors. That's less than 1% of the population.
Yeah.
So unless you make it accessible to people at a fee and, you know, reduce this fee that is there, you know, feet on the street will not get you there. We have to reimagine the way that we do financial inclusion, put more money into investors' pockets.
But which is an argument that is completely separate, I would argue. I mean, that's actually getting in an argument to get more people in and do the financial inclusion. But for people who are actually investing in mutual funds right now or seeing this show or otherwise and wanting to do, I think this show, we should talk about what is actually better for them. Now, there's an argument for and against both the pieces, and frankly, none of the arguments are wrong. And which is why I want to get in Tarun Birani out here, because Tarun, I believe you straddle both the aspects. You also have this advisory platform, and I believe you started on that online robo advisory platform as well. What is your judgment of how would the two products or the two methods work for an average investor in India? I constantly bring back this topic of an average investor in India, because I think in by virtue of doing this show for the last 1.5 years, I've realized that there are two very distinct kinds of investors. There are a set of investors who understand mutual funds at the back of their hand and who ask me questions at times that even I am not aware of, and I'm not aware of things a lot of times. But there are a set of people who are just not aware about how to go about investing in mutual funds, let alone choosing those funds. So for a market like India, what are your thoughts?
So, first of all, this platform, what we have launched, one clarification, this Thinking Man platform which we have launched, this is more of a financial planning, okay, digital delivery platform. That's what we have created. That's on the planning part, and I'll talk a little more about it. But the important part on this direct and regular discussion which we were having, the most important part which I feel need relevance is who is compensating. That is extremely important. The compensation. So, compensation paid by the manufacturer or compensation paid by the principal? Who is the principal and manufacturer here, right? So, the good part about the direct plan is, apart from the cost benefit, which I feel is a extremely minuscule discussion, it doesn't weigh that much weightage.
It's 2:1 right now, I can see that, but that's okay. Huh?
The most important part which I feel is relevant is who is compensating, the independence part of it, right? What you are advising,
Explain how independent
it is, right? Hmm. So the good part about the direct investing is, let's say even if the advisor is giving a direct plan, since he is not going to make any money from the manufacturer, so he has to negotiate the price from the client directly, right?
This is if there is an advisor who's direct investing and not taking the money
from
the
there funds. Are RIA models available where you can do that, right? So the good part about that process is it's completely independent, wherein the advisor is going to advise based on what is good for the client, right? And the compensation is directly decided between the client and the advisor, right? And there is no commissions which are involved from the manufacturer.
Sure. So again, which is the mutual fund.
Yeah. So this gives a strong edge in terms of the suitability part. So what is good for the client? And we have seen hordes of mis-selling which has happened in our industry. And that's where there has been a survey wherein financial services industry confidence from the investor side is very low. Because of this mis-selling all of the time, because the products where the highest commissions were there, those were sold and missold all the times, right? So due to that, the direct plan offers that kind of flexibility to the client, wherein they are able to compensate directly to the advisor, yeah, based on the value what they are receiving.
Sure.
Yeah. So that is one thing. Compensation gives a very independent viewpoint to the client. Talking about the second viewpoint, which I see all across the industry, just because of cost saving, getting into a direct plan, again, there is a very big problem I can see coming from that. So last
which
one
is?
Year, yeah, last one year, big amount of ads were, I've seen on ads where you save 1-1.5% and get into this. A lot of investors got into this, but they are not aware that this is a prescription-based medicine. It's not a do-it-yourself kind of thing.
Why do you say that?
Yeah, so I'll explain that.
And I'm sure Kunal wanted to contest that as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, yeah. I'll talk about it.
Yeah.
And I've shared something on that also, where money involves behavior. Yeah.
Okay, you're talking about the Vanguard study.
Yeah.
Okay, so we should bring that up as well. Maybe Tarun wanted to speak about that.
Yeah.
Can you explain this?
Yeah.
What
does
the study entail?
Yeah,
because
yeah.
I haven't read it.
Right.
You
right.
have.
Yeah. So investing is a prescription-based medicine. It's not a do-it-yourself kind of thing. And that's where I have clients who are chartered accountants, IITian, IIMs, from IIMs. But the problem with managing your own money is your own behavior will always play into that, right? And you will end up taking a lot of decision which may not be correct or rational. And you need a very dispassionate exercise to take care of it, right? The problem with all these euphoria which has been created in the media and all, wherein let's say you are saving 1-1.5%, people tend to make investment without any suitability and they just jump into it. And I see the big problem with these all these robo-advisory or the tech platform, there's no human interface into it. Money management requires at least somebody to be there where they can talk, understand their concern. You are handling someone's future goals, right? Their dreams, aspirations, everything is involved in that. So on a mass scale, yes, you can create platform, but you are not dealing portfolios. You are dealing with human beings, right? So you need to have a human interface in it. So I strongly believe there need to be some bit of hand-holding around their goals, their suitability, and based on that product need to be given. There is no problem with the direct platform.
Sure.
But the problem is they are missold. Again, there is a lot of mis-selling happening in the direct platform. That's what I see right now with the advent of so many.
Sorry, can you just care to explain that point?
Yeah.
The mis-selling in the direct platforms?
Yeah. So I can see there are hordes of tech platforms, and all these platforms have been funded by private equities. Yeah. So the money. So we know the typical Paytm kind of model where they don't care of the profits what they are going to make today. After 5-10 years, they are going to recover that. Right? So these private equity funds are putting hordes of money just to get investors today.
Yeah, but what's the mis-selling that is happening?
Yeah, so mis-selling is wherein you position that you are saving 1.5% extra and you get them in the platform. Yeah. And the suitability part, the suitability exercise, the client don't know anything about the mid-cap fund, small-cap fund, just because of past performance, he is going to invest in that. And due to that, we have seen in last 6 months, mid-cap funds have been down 30%.
Sure.
Yeah. So there comes, he feels like, oh, this is not good for me. He stops the SIP. And again, so where is the experience, happy customers we are creating?
You know, Tarun, the only way I would counter that, and I would come to you as well, Amol, but I just want Kunal to come in out here. The only way I would counter that point is, I don't think any of the robo-advisory or the direct platforms are telling investors that we'll be able to tell you or prescribe to you what is happening. The selling point of a direct model is that it's easily accessible to you. And if you want, you can save the cost. Right,
so
Kunal, I don't think you've ever gone out and said that you're going to give or tell people that, hey, I know what is the best thing for you to do. If you know what is good for you, here's me who's giving you a cost-effective model.
Sure. So let me take that from Tarun, right? I think India is a large enough country, and for every truth that you can prove, there is a hypothesis that you have, there is an equally valid opposite hypothesis, right? So you can, you know, pinpoint to this one customer who has had a bad experience, but I can also pinpoint to a million offline customers who've had terrible experiences with human advisors, including myself. Case in point is people who go into bank branches asking for a tax-saving fund, walk out with a ULIP, right? A much more expensive product that is actually not suited for them. Case in point is, you know, going to a physical human advisor, asking for your returns and your statements, and the advisor will talk to you about how they've done so exceptionally well over the last 5 years or 3 years, or whatever convenient time frame suits, you know, makes them look better. The point I'm making over here is very, very simple. At the end of the day, we are SEBI regulated. At the end of the day, we are doing a risk questionnaire and risk profiling, and we are recommending what we think is the most appropriate product, or rather most appropriate savings instrument, to take the customer to their goal. So, you know, within that, if you can help the customer reach his goal, what that goal could be 25 lakh rupees or 50 lakh rupees or 1 crore rupees, if you can help that customer reach that same goal by taking less risk, you know, not by buying a very risky bond fund, by buying actually a less risky bond fund, sure, because you get better returns in a direct plan, and get him to that goal 5 years or 7 years earlier, I don't see why anyone has a problem. The only people that seem to have a problem are people with, you know, who can't, you know, recognize the fact that this is actually in the customer's interest.
Okay, so I can counter that as well. And I would want Amol to have a word on this. And then we have a bunch of queries that have already come in on the live show. Sure. So I would want you guys to address that. Yes. But just one small counter, sure, to that, Kunal. And we're running slightly, sure, short of time, so I may not be able to give all of you, okay, a chance to respond. But just one small counter to that, Kunal, is that embedded in the assumption out there that over a 15-year period, a direct or a robo-advisory platform is giving the customer the best suitable plan, is that the advisory firm, after 2 years, if there is a change, is not being able to tell the customer, if he doesn't know it himself or herself, that there is a deviation here, so get out of that plan.
There is. That's exactly what I'm saying, right? So you don't buy a single mutual fund and say, hold it for the next 30 years. There is a rebalance that happens periodically that is communicated to the investor. It's with investor consent that we basically say, look, we don't think this strategy is working out as, okay, well as we planned. And here's what we would like to do. We move away from strategy A to strategy B,
okay,
fund A to fund B, okay, within that same large cap space.
Fair call.
The idea really is to be able to do it in a convenient manner, right? And in a sense, it is no different from a bank platform, right? When you go and do and log into your private bank account and you say, I want to buy mutual funds, that itself is a do-it-yourself model. And that is actually more expensive because that's do-it-yourself with regular funds.
Yeah, so that I agree. That point is well taken. The query only comes in into models wherein, say, experts like Amol, for example,
sure,
were not tied up with the bank necessarily, yeah, but have the best interest of the investor as hard. Amol, you want to come in? Because I have to take in a lot of queries here.
Sure, one, yes, I wanted to make one point along with Tarun's point. He mentioned about mis-selling. I would say there is even bigger problem of mis-buying. He also mentioned about one of the recent launches of an online direct, you know, app or platform. When you opened the app, when you filled in your details, when you actually wanted to go for investment, the first fund that was shown was World Energy Fund. Okay, the kind of volatility that fund is going to give you, it's going to give you nightmares. Not many funds, or not many investors, typical Indian investor, can digest that. One. Second point is, the second fund that was shown in the same app, one of the largest downloaded apps in first 24 hours, so on and so forth, was the small cap fund. And Tarun also mentioned second point is these funds are down. Small cap, mid cap funds are down 30%, 25% in last 6 months. The first time investor who came purely looking at the convenience of the model is not going to come back if you make his 100 rupees into a nice round figure of 70 rupees. That's the limited point. Again, I'm saying it's not direct versus regular. It's who should buy direct and who should get a regular. When I say regular, it means a human advice. Platforms are a great news and Kunal, these days distributors also have their own apps, own platforms. So if you are talking about the reach is there equally from the direct platform as well as regular. But who should buy should be the real discussion here.
Well, maybe, and that's the only solution that comes into this. Tarun, I have a 30-second window out here if you, yeah, want to make this
so
point.
So I just want to make that Vanguard study on that human face with the platform thing together mix if we can create a hybrid platform.
Mm-hmm.
So in that, Vanguard have shown extra alpha, which advisor, prescription-based versus a direct investing, extra 3% returns were generated in United States context. And in Indian context, I can say it is more than 5% annually, annual returns. That's the advisor alpha, the extra alpha based on behavior coaching. What is behavior coaching? Managing your behavior, hand-holding. Yes, your platform is giving advice to rebalance, but how many people will do it? There is a requirement of hand-holding, right? to touch the emotions. Not everybody will do it, right?
Yeah.
So advising and executing, that's a very different thing. I see a very big gap, and there is a very big return which is there in between.
Okay. So I think the
summation. So that's the problem. Yeah.
No, so. But I think the summation, and please correct me if I'm wrong, gentlemen, then we'll have to take in the queries, because Akanksha, Dheeraj, and a bunch of others have queries, and we'll just get to those queries in a bit, important ones pertaining to the current topic. I think the summation would be that if you know your funds and your investments at the back of your hand, then maybe direct investing through an advisory platform is a no-brainer, because you know what you want to buy, so you choose the least cost option or the ones which gives you possibly the best bang for the buck. There is a deviation out here wherein even if you are smart enough, Tarun Birani would say that money management is a completely different ball game, and maybe you should let a dispassionate person manage that and take those decisions for you. Of course, if you do not know too much about mutual funds, then maybe going to a direct platform, sorting it via the best performing fund over the last 2 years or 3 years and choosing that fund might not necessarily be the best platform, in which case, if you don't know funds, maybe go through an advisor. I believe, gentlemen, that would be a fair summary of,
sure, of course,
who should be doing it as opposed to what is the best or what is the better route. Right. Now, a few questions that have come in, and any of you can take the call of answering these. Akanksha is asking on Twitter, she's asking, how can you switch your existing regular mutual fund plan to a direct plan? Any of you has a thought on this?
It can be done via a paper-based request, a form-based request. That's the first way of doing it. Second way is simply log into the fund house where you have invested, create your own account and switch from your fund house login ID. Just log in and you can do the switch. So offline as well as online, via any of these two methods, you can switch from direct to regular to direct, whichever way you want.
I'll just add something over there, exactly what Amol said. The only thing that you need to consider is the fact that it is a taxable event. So sure, when you move from a regular fund to a direct fund, it effectively means like you're selling X and you're buying Y, and therefore there might be some taxes that you need to pay on X, particularly now that there's taxation on equity mutual funds. What we're introducing on the MobiKwik app in the next couple of weeks is just you'll be able to log in onto either CAMS or Carvi, consolidate all of your holdings in one place. We will show you what your taxable, what taxes you'll need to pay, and we can help you switch from regular to direct.
Okay.
Since we are getting into the details, along with tax, you also have to be mindful of the exit load.
Absolutely.
Okay. So most equity funds do have an exit load of 1% if you are holding it for less than 1 year period. So you'll have to be mindful of tax as well as the exit load.
That's a comprehensive answer, all right. Ridhima Saini is asking if, Dheeraj Mehra, let me get to Dheeraj Mehra's query first. He wants to know if some fund companies have slashed the expense ratios in regular plans, they are not bringing down the cost in the direct plans in the same way. Any thoughts, any of you?
Yeah, so SEBI has recently come up with a reduction in the TER, which is yet to be implemented.
Okay.
Yet to be implemented. But recently, SEBI made sure that the commission mode paid is only through a trail basis to the advisors. So earlier, there used to be a lot of upfront cost which used to be paid directly to the advisors. So due to that, there is some reallocation in terms of expense ratio from both regular and direct plan, which is happening right now.
Okay.
Yeah, so I think
not quite exactly linked, but still nevertheless, since it was about cost, I thought I'll take it. Shashank Kotak, and Shashank, I think we gave the answer already, but your question was about whether new and inexperienced investors should considering investing in regular plans, even though they offer relatively lower returns. I use the term relatively, even though you didn't mention the word relatively, because I think funds by and large would probably give better returns than some other modes. Tarun wants to answer, but I think we gave a brief answer that if you're a new and inexperienced investor, then getting handheld by somebody might be a better ploy. I think all three of our experts agreed to that. Tarun, you want to come in first, and I think Kunal wants to give an answer.
I strongly believe that their purpose and goal need to be very clearly defined, and based on that suitability, mid-term, short-term, long-term, what is the requirement? Based on that, the fund allocation, selection, and everything need to be done. So it can't be done. Otherwise, the experience may go bad, and we could not create happy compounding stories for them. Yeah,
okay, that's
so I have a slightly different way of saying the same thing, to the viewer Deepak, right?
It's Shashank.
And I call it Shashank, sorry. So Shashank, I think the answer to this is, what I would call the bad uncle problem. I have an uncle, Neeraj has an uncle, you have an uncle. That doesn't necessarily make him a good uncle. So just having an advisor doesn't necessarily make him a good advisor. If you're comfortable with your advisor, please go ahead and do a regular fund. If you're not comfortable with an advisor, look around for a platform that you're comfortable with, that you think works in your best interest. And, you know, that's basically the promise of, you know, what some of us are trying to do online.
Mm. Yeah, but in Shashank's case, I presume he doesn't even have an uncle in the first place. So he probably needs to go out and look for a good uncle. Well, some of them usually come on the mutual fund show, Shashank, so maybe you can take advice from them as well. Ridhima Saini, we won't be able to take your question about hold or redeem, because I think that answer is given almost every single time on the mutual fund show, that mutual funds are a product for the long term. If you are indeed invested, stay invested for the long term. In fact, when the markets are correcting, it's probably a good time to buy more into mutual funds because you get more units for the same amount. So, yep, I think that's the long and short answer of this. But yeah, I know there are a lot more queries. Unfortunately, we've run out of time on the show. We'll request our guests out here, though, that during the course of the week, if they do manage to find the time, that they can respond to some of these queries online as well. So we'll get some of the responses going. And for all of you who missed the show, please mind you, the show will be there on the website as well. So do log on to BloombergQuint.com and get a slice of this conversation. It was a divided house, but a unanimous verdict of sorts and a very amicable discussion. So, gentlemen, thank you so much for joining in today.
Pleasure.
Really appreciate your time and being with us on the Mutual Fund Show today. And viewers, thanks for tuning in to this leg of the Mutual Fund Show.